Hi, my name is Timmy Willis, and so glad that you tuned in to another exciting episode. We're here with a very exciting, extremely talented individual. Ladies and gentlemen, it brings me great pleasure to bring to you Mr. Tubby Daniels. How you doing, man?
I'm okay, brother. How you doing?
I'm doing good, man. I'm so glad you had took time out to come down and sit down and talk with us for a little while. People have been enjoying your music for a long time, so this is an opportunity for them to get a little glimpse into who Tubby Daniels is. So let's get started. Let's go all the way back to the beginning. Okay. Where were you born?
Right here in Pittsburgh.
What part of Pittsburgh?
Hill District. I'm from the Hill District.
You're from the Hill District?
Yeah.
Now, what was it like for you growing up there as a little boy?
Well, I had a lot of fun as a kid. Mm-hmm. You know, went to the Pittsburgh Public Schools, mm-hmm. A.L.O. Wild First, Robert L. Vann, mm-hmm. Here and Hill,
okay,
and Shenley High.
Yeah. Now, as a little boy, what did you do for fun?
Well, for the most part, I hung a lot with my dad.
Okay.
And my dad had a boxing gym.
Oh.
And I did a lot of boxing as a kid.
Yeah.
Not competitively, but just falling behind my dad.
Mm-hmm.
And just wanting to be with my dad. So, and he stayed in the gym.
Right.
So that was something that I did as a kid. It wasn't popular back then.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it got popular until, may he rest in peace, Muhammad Ali took it up. I mean, Sugar Ray Robinson, of course, was great, you know.
Right.
And it was probably popular back then even, but even more popular once Muhammad Ali got in the game.
Right, right.
So when I was coming up, the gym wasn't like playing football or basketball, but that's what I was able to do because I grew up in it.
Right, right. And in case, for those who do not know, Tubby's his father was a Pittsburgh icon, Charlie. They called him Charlie Daniels. And he had a very prominent gym in Pittsburgh, which we're going to talk about a little bit later on. But you're a very accomplished musician. Many people have been enjoying your playing for many decades, but will you tell them, what is the name of the instrument that you chose to play?
It's called a vibraphone.
A vibraphone. So how did that come into your life? I mean, what was it about that particular instrument that caught your interest?
Well, I think the first person I saw playing it was Johnny Lytle.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was crazy about the way he played, and was at the Crawford Grill, and it was so up and close, mm-hmm. like your show, up close and personal.
Yeah.
And I don't even think I was old enough to be in there at the time, but we don't have to talk about that.
Right.
But, I was right up in front, and it was just so sweet, you know, the music wasn't, he played so smooth, too, and sweet, you know,
mm-hmm.
and I always said that, oh man, I wish I could play those things.
Yeah.
But it just drifted right past. You know how you tell yourself, I'm going to do that one day, I'm going to do that. And you don't get into it.
Right. Well, do you remember how old you were then?
That probably was around 18 or
about
17.
17, 18.
Yeah.
But it was the sound of the instrument that caught
it was
interest?
The sound. And the way he played it,
mm-hmm.
you know, the way he played it. And it was amazing to me, you know. And I've heard the vibes before in different songs, but not that close, you know. And watching him do it and watching him move as he mm-hmm. played, I was really fascinated by that. I said, oh, that's great.
Yeah.
So that stuck with me for a while, but I never picked up the vibraphones. Until I started playing the piano.
Oh, you played the piano?
Yeah, a little bit.
Now, how did that come into your life? What made you start tickling the keys?
Well, You don't remember, but I told you this story before. My sister got an organ for Christmas.
Okay.
And I don't think that she played it that much, maybe around the first week of Christmas.
Okay.
But the organ stayed in the house. It was just a small organ, and I would always tinker around with it.
Mm-hmm.
And I found that it was easy to me. I picked it up easy. So at some point, I decided to play in a band. And my cousin, Bucky, that's my cousin, okay. Bucky Daniels, he said, my cousin could play, but I really wasn't well enough to play in the band, but I picked it up fast enough to play in the band because that's what I wanted to do once he introduced me to his band. Mm-hmm. So that's how I started playing music, period.
Well, did you guys play out anywhere?
We had a couple gigs. Did you? Know? Yeah, we had a couple gigs.
Okay, well, now that you said that, now take us there. What was it first time that you performed in front of an audience, man? You're in the band, you playing the keyboard.
Now, you're going so far back.
What was that feeling like, man?
You're going so far back, I don't know. But I do know the feeling. Don't ask me where the gig was or how much we got paid or anything like that because I don't remember that.
Okay.
But I can always remember feeling good playing any instrument whenever I did touch the instrument.
Uh-huh.
Always felt good. And it's always accomplishment whether I'm trying to learn a complicated piece or an easy piece. It's always a good accomplishment once I tackle it, once I learn it. So, and the confidence I have after I learn it, it's, I don't know how to explain it. It's like, I'm ready to put it out there. It doesn't matter how many's in the audience or whatever. I just,
right.
I know it's going to be right.
Yeah.
So it's a good feeling.
Good. Now, how long did you stay with that band?
Probably 2 days.
Really?
No. It was, like I said, it was so long ago,
Yeah.
But it wasn't long. It was just a part of what I, made me begin or what helped me to begin playing.
Okay. Yeah. So after you left that group, did you join another group on keyboards or?
Actually, I did. Back in the day, me and you spoke about the name, and that was Winston Carter and Little Chucky Carter, we played together.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, we played together and had a lot of fun back in the day.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and Chucky and both Chucky and Winston has always been so talented.
Yeah.
I like both of them, but that Chucky, I mean, he's always been talented. I don't know how, I mean, from day one, he could sing and play them drums.
Uh-huh.
I mean, Winston could sing and play too, but it was just something about Chucky, I don't know. But yeah we enjoyed ourselves as young men, because at that time I was a young man playing the piano then.
Yeah. Okay, so you played with the Carter brothers there for a while.
Mm-hmm.
So once you left that musical situation, what did you do after that musically?
Musically, I got with a group called the East Coast Boys.
The East Coast Boys.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We were pretty good, and we had a lot of fun. I mean, most of the groups I got with was just basically a lot of fun.
Uh-huh.
Especially before I started learning how to really play in terms of reading, and because I'm not gonna say I wasn't really playing, but once I started reading out Dr. James Johnson, once I went to his school and started reading, it started getting more real.
Yeah.
But up until then, it was always fun, and it like it is now. But up until then, it was not theoretically fun. You know what I mean?
Gotcha.
Yeah, it was just roughing it, so to speak.
Mm-hmm. So around this time, it seems like you was around maybe in your 20s?
Right. I was in my 20s. Yeah,
okay. And so the East Coast Boys, and so, I mean, after a while, you left that musical situation.
Yeah.
And what did you do from there?
Well, I was with a group called the Funk Brothers. And,
Not the Funk Brothers.
Yeah. The Funky Band is what we call that.
The Funky Band.
The Funky Band.
Yeah. Yeah,
not the Funk Brothers from Motown.
Okay.
I wish. No, but we called ourselves the Funky Band. And and we had some good musicians and two great singers.
Yeah.
I don't know if you ever heard of Alfredo Russell. He was
Alfredo,
like,
that sounds familiar.
Yeah, he's a good friend of mine's, and he was our manager back then. And
Alfredo,
yeah.
Alfredo,
right? Yeah,
yeah. Matter of fact, Chef Alfredo, I had him right here on this show.
Yeah, okay.
And he did some cooking and interviewed him. He is a fascinating individual as well.
Good brother.
So you know Chef Alfredo.
He's a good brother.
Yeah, he's your man.
Yeah, he was.
So y'all brother. Played around the Pittsburgh area.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah.
We did, and we had fun. It was a good group. A couple good singers, Curtis Jacobson. I don't remember Rob's last name, but Rob, he sung, and it was a good group. I remember all the guys, but like I said, a lot of that was in the past, so.
Yeah. Now, the kind of music you guys were playing, what kind of music was you guys playing? Was it top 40, jazz, blues, or?
It was pretty much top 40,
R&B. Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's pretty much what the kind of music you wanted to play at that particular time?
Well, at that time, I didn't know what I wanted to do. You know, I just wanted to have fun and I enjoyed playing.
Yeah.
So whatever ideas most of the other guys would come up with in the band usually sounded good to me. I was like, okay, I'll do that. Either. It was rare that I would say, nah, I don't want to play that. You know, I went along with just about whatever came down the pipe. But like I said, until I got in James Johnson school and I started learning how to read and wanting to step out on my own, everything before that was just a bunch of fun and whatever.
Right. Now, what at that point in your life, what was your practice regimen like? Did you practice every day on your own at home or?
Well, again, back then, like I say, that's why I think it was just fun and anything went, because it didn't take a whole lot of work.
Okay.
It didn't take a whole lot of practice.
Yeah.
Until, and I keep saying James school, until I got in that school.
Yeah.
And once I got in that school, it was, oh, this goes like this. And, you know, this shouldn't be here. And, you know, then he started introducing me to different musicians that I was not aware of. I mean, I heard of their names like Charlie Parker, Miles Davis, John Coltrane, and try this song and try that song. Now you got to sit down and, oh, okay.
Yeah.
You got to take your time, read, and, you know. So that's when the practice start coming in real hard. I will say hard, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, good. Well, look here. When we come back, could you tell us a little bit more about what that experience was like for you when you first actually start formally studying music, formally reading music and learning all these different formal things about your craft. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back with the one and only Mr. Tubby Daniels. Don't go nowhere.
All right.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Hill House. You're being entertained by the Tubby Daniels Band, and we are happy to open for Ronnie Laws. Ladies and gentlemen, on the piano, Mr. Howie Alexander. On the guitar, Ronald Wakefield. On the bass, Ronald Biggs. My younger brother on the drums, y'all, give it up for Mike Finch. Yeah.
Just joining us, you are missing it. My name is Timmy Willis, and we're here with the very extremely talented Mr. Tubby Daniels. Tubby, before we went to the break, we were talking about you had started formally studying music with Dr. James Johnson. What was that experience like for you when you finally started seeing music and learning how to read music and how to technically execute your instrument?
Well, at first I was beating myself up for not doing it sooner.
Mm-hmm.
Because my mother and father had a close friend, Robert Head, who was great on the piano. And he tried several times talking me into learning how to read, and I never took him up on it. So when I finally started, I said, oh wow, this is what I've been missing, mm-hmm. you know. And I don't like to take nothing away from some of the musicians that do a great job by playing without reading. But for me, it helped me so much, you know. So I don't know, it just put me down a path to do it correctly for me.
Right.
Yeah. Before that, I was just playing, simple songs that didn't require a lot of reading. I couldn't go to some of the musicians that I met after I left some of those groups that we were talking about. I couldn't face some of those musicians without knowing how to read,
right.
like the great Donna Davis and Herb Marshalls and Dr. Leonard Johnson, and mm-hmm. who, you know, I play with a lot, and he's great, you know.
Yeah.
And just, you know, musicians from around here, Tony Campbell, you know, mm-hmm. you can't just go up to them playing some of the stuff I was playing before I met them without reading a note.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what it did for me.
So for the younger ones that's watching, what advice would you give to a young musician coming up as far as reading music versus not reading music?
Well, I didn't want to get into all this about reading music, but I would simply say, why not? And like I said, when I met with Robert Head, which was a friend of my family's, and I turned him down. Years later, I beat myself up. I said, why didn't I just listen to him years ago? I would have been so far ahead, mm-hmm. instead of trying to pick it up now or, you know, later. So I would say if you have opportunity, and especially in school, mm-hmm. why not? Just take the time out and learn how to read. Yeah. Note at a time if necessary. Just take your time and do it slow and get it correctly. It's like building a house. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to start with the foundation, and you got to start, you know, make it strong. So I would say start from the very beginning and stick with it.
Right.
Stick with it. That's another thing. You don't want to start and quit, mm-hmm. you know. So that would be my advice.
Yeah, so y'all heard that, right? Reading music is very valuable. Don't underestimate it. Okay, you're at the African American Institute. I believe that's the name of it.
Right.
And actually, it's still there. And so once you started reading, did you notice that as far as your playing, you found yourself playing with in different musical situations that you wouldn't normally have been in if you weren't reading music?
Of course.
Yeah.
For me, that's the way it was. Like I said, there are some musicians that probably can go from where I was at just with the ear. Mm-hmm. But for me, that's what it took for me. So once I started learning how to read, and I'm not fluent at it to this day, but I do read music. But once I started learning how to read, it took me to a different level.
Yeah. So what if, as far as keyboard players, who was your influences at during that time? Did anybody in particular that you listen to?
Before that time, I was listening to Motown. So
Motown.
Yeah. Like I said, before I got to the school, I was listening to just mostly R&B, you know, mainly Motown. Mm-hmm. And if I did listen to jazz piano, I liked the Jazz Crusaders, and I liked Ramsey Lewis back then, you know. Mm-hmm. And I started listening to Oscar Peterson and Art Tatum and music like that after I left the school.
Yeah.
But before that, you know, it seemed like the smoother the better for me back then. Mm-hmm. You know, I still kind of like that.
Yeah.
Smooth. Not necessarily smooth jazz, but I do like smooth jazz, but just smooth piano playing. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, I know now you have your own band now, the Tubby Daniels Band, but is this your first band, or did you have your own band before the band that you have now?
No. I think what happened was I got tired of sitting in with other bands because it's not every day a vibraphone player get called to play in a band or to play with a band. Mm-hmm. So I had to put my own group together in order to keep playing or just keep sitting in. Mm-hmm. And then sometimes I wasn't even allowed to sit in.
Yeah.
You know, for one, my instrument is not small. It's a large instrument, so it takes up a lot of room. For two, most bands will call a drummer, a bass player, keyboard or guitar, maybe a horn. Mm-hmm. You're going to not find too many bands that say, we need some vibraphones.
Yeah.
So I had to put my own group together.
Okay.
And that's how that came about.
Okay. Well, when we come back, would you please tell us about your dad? Like I mentioned earlier, you know, he's a Pittsburgh icon. And what that experience was like for you growing up in the gym and everything. And somebody, maybe you could share with us some of the experiences that you've been able to witness at the gym.
Okay, be glad right. to.
Ladies and gentlemen, don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with Mr. Tubby Daniels. Don't go nowhere.
Thank you very much. A little something by Al Jarreau called Morning. Mm-hmm. thank you. I took the opportunity to read the August Wilson book, Fences. And so I wrote a song based on the book. It's entitled Birth of Raynell. And right about this time, we'd like to bring up our lovely singer, Mrs. Sandra Green Camp. Sandra Green Camp, y'all.
There's no more to say.
Mrs. Sandy Green Camp, y'all.
Oh, my name is Timmy Willis, and I'm here with the very talented Mr. Tubby Daniels. And before we went to the break, matter of fact, ladies and gentlemen, during the break, Tubby reminded me that once before I had interviewed him, which has slipped my mind, so forgive me about that, but we were talking about his father, who was, like I said, was a Pittsburgh icon, Charlie Daniels, with the boxing gym. And tell me, what was that experience like for you growing up in that environment? And what were some of the fond memories that you have during that time?
Well, my dad was a good man, as well as my mom was a good mother, you know, good woman. And I had two good parents, so... I remember my dad as that more so than anything, you know. But in terms of the boxing, he was a great coach. He coached a lot of young men. They speak well of him to this day. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them gained a lot of discipline and just righteousness in life because of him. And that's what they tell me, you know, so I know it to be true because that's what he continually taught at the gym other than just boxing. Mm-hmm. But in terms of boxing, I think he was great at conditioning. You know, you didn't go in that gym without doing some exercises. You could put the gloves on, but you had to do... exercise first, sit-ups, push-ups, pull-ups, you know, run the track, you know, run the shimmy oval. All of his fighters, it's a hard word to say all, but most of his fighters were in good shape.
Yeah.
And I think that's what won over their opponents a lot, the fact that they were in good shape and the fact that he was such a disciplinarian when it came to getting in shape. Mm-hmm. And to this day, that helps me, you know.
Yeah.
I'm don't want to say how old I am, but I stay in shape to this day, and I think it's because of that beginning I had with my dad.
Right.
You know, he was a great coach, you know, and to this day, that's what I do.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's funny you said that because I know I had come over to the YMCA over in the Hill District not long ago.
Right.
And when I walked in the room, man, I seen the gym and this great big boxing ring. Right. And you were in the ring, man, with a young man.
Yeah.
And it touched me, man, because I could remember seeing your father. And I didn't know until that moment that you were carrying that on, you know what I mean? And so, could you tell us a little bit about that? How long have you been doing that? And
I've been doing that for 2 years now.
Okay.
Started with my son, my younger son, Chaz, and I wanted to take him and show him some fundamentals. And we went out to East Liberty Gym. Was being ran by Darren Dobie, who was a great coach and a good friend. And then he got the gym where I'm at now, the Center Avenue YMCA. And I would just go in first just to be working with my son, but obviously I would have to help out with the other kids. Mm-hmm. And that's what I end up doing. Now I'm stuck there. And I say it like that because it's not something that I wanted to do. And my dad used to say that all the time. He said, you got to want to do this, you know. This got to be your passion. You got to want to do this. Right. And I called up a couple of his older fighters or younger fighters at the time, but and asked them to come and help me. And they tell me, you know, Tub, I want to help, man, but that ain't my passion. And I have to understand that.
Okay.
Because it's not easy. Mm-hmm. And I'm doing just what he did, and I see just what he's talking about or was talking about. There's no pay involved.
Right.
You know, and I'm up there every day from Monday to Thursday, you know, from 6 to 8. I'm not complaining, but I'm saying that to say, to get someone else to come in and do it, yeah, it's not easy.
Right.
So, but when you see one of them kids learning, and I mean, it's a good feeling.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if I got this thing about just learning, you know, when we were talking about the music.
Right.
But when you see a kid learn how to hold his hands up when he didn't know how, or she, because we have young girls coming to the gym too.
Mm-hmm.
And most kids, just like when you go back to any kid that mostly come to the gym, someone like Ali took their bike, beat them up, done something to them in school, and they don't want to keep putting up with that. So they come to the gym. And when you see a kid with a little low self-confidence, or, you know, just come to the gym and learn how to put their hands up and throw a jab and move their feet around and start smiling again, mm-hmm, you know, it's a good feeling.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so it's hard to let it go.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of times I'll be like, it's time to go to the gym.
Yeah.
You know, but once I get there, and like I said about working out, and at the age I'm at now,
mm-hmm,
it don't hurt. You know, I don't be wanting to go sometime, but once I get there and we're doing our push-ups and sit-ups, mm-hmm, and because that's the way I do it. I do it the same way I was taught.
Right.
Before you put on the gloves, before you, let's get in the ring, let's do our sit-ups, touch our toes, stretch. You know, we do all of that.
Yeah.
You know.
So you actually benefit as well.
That's the only way. That's the only way I can get paid. Mm-hmm. So I'm paying myself. So
yeah,
when I'm there every day, I'm doing my sit-ups, I'm doing my push-ups, you know, jumping jacks, stretches. You know, we do it all. Touch your toes. We call it the matrix where you go, you know, we do every exercise that you could think of before we do anything else.
Oh.
Then we run around that track, which is the balcony, but we call it the track.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's part of how I get my benefit out of it, as well as watching the kids learn. So
yeah. Well, another accomplishment that that I've come become aware of in connection with you is that you are a firefighter.
Yeah.
And you know, could you tell us a little bit about that? Because you weren't just a firefighter, but you had climbed the ladder, literally.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, a friend of mine's, Thomas Housie, we would be in the basketball court playing basketball, and looked up one day, he's on the back of the fire truck. I said, "Hey, man, how'd you do that?" He told me what to do, where to go, you know. And that's how I got on the job.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, I like the fire department. I stayed there for 27 years.
Oh, okay.
And I was also in the service. And so I was able to buy 3 years. On our job, we were able to do that. You can buy 3 years. So that gave me a total of 30 years. And there's not a lot more I can say about the fire department other than the 27 years, the 3 years that I brought, and I got out of there.
Well, just before you got out of there, you was getting ready to become captain?
Correct.
Yeah.
Well, I was a lieutenant, and I stayed to be a captain, and I was next on the list to become captain, but retirement sounded better. And it didn't matter if I was next on the list or the next day to be promoted. Retirement just sounded better to me.
Mm-hmm.
At the time, they were offering free health care for you and your spouse on the job. They were offering several other benefits that I don't want to, you know, discuss, but mm-hmm, the following year was not going to be there. So that was more important to me than staying around to make captain. So I just said, y'all could have it. You know, I'm going. Get my pension. And I don't regret it.
Uh-huh. Very good. Well, look here. When we come back, everyone who has had the pleasure and privilege of seeing you perform on the Vibes. Now, that instrument came into your life at some point, at some kind of way. Could you please tell us that? And also, Denzel Washington has been in Pittsburgh, and you have a connection with him. So could you share that with us when we come back?
Sure.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, don't go nowhere. Stick and stay, don't go away. Take a slug from a jug, and we'll be right back.
Of your time, you're making me weak. Cast a spell on me, your control over me. I can't resist no matter how I try. Your love has got me hypnotized. Oh, closer and closer. say, believe that love will be baby. Won't believe that, baby. Some say, believe that love will be baby. Some somebody, don't baby.
We like to do a tune by Wayne Shorter entitled Footprints. Is there any way we can get some water up here, please? Some water.
Just joining us. My name is Timmy Willis, and I'm here with the very extremely talented Mr. Tubby Daniels. And before we went to the break, we were talking about your instrument of choice now, the vibraphone. How did that instrument come into your life? Because, I mean, ladies and gentlemen, let me rephrase it, because you already told us how you became aware of it. Mm-hmm. And then you started playing the keyboards, but you really didn't pick up the vibraphone. But at some point in your life, you actually picked them up, and you're excellent at it now. So how did that come back into your life?
Well, I appreciate you saying I'm excellent, but I'm not excellent. But I will say this.
He's excellent, y'all.
I'll say this. I did tell you I enjoyed hearing Johnny Lytle as a young man, and it just drifted out of the equation. Then I started studying music with Dr. James Johnson at the Afro-American Music Institute in Homewood. And at some point, I went to the Zebra Room and before I went there, I met with Carl Arter, and he informed me that he would be at the Zebra Room mm-hmm. to come hearing. And when I went there, I met Eddie Rabbit Barnes.
Oh, yeah.
And that was my buddy. He was great on the vibraphones. Mm-hmm. And actually knew Johnny Lytle. He knew Johnny Lytle.
Okay.
And he, just the way he played, I wanted to play the vibes. I said, oh, yeah, this is my first, mm-hmm. And from that point on, I just started on the vibes.
So what you did, you went out and bought you some?
I went out and brought some with Rabbit.
Okay.
I took him with me, mm-hmm. and he picked it out. Well, actually, I had already saw him, and I wasn't sure, because they weren't like Musters, or they were Jinkos, old. Mm-hmm. And he told me, yeah, they're okay, you know. So I went on and brought them, yeah.
Yeah, you've been smoking them ever since, man.
Well, thank you.
Yeah. Well, look here. Denzel Washington's been in town, and you have a connection with Denzel. Would you tell us about that?
Yeah, I've been getting a lot of Denzel Washington stories and Denzel Washington jokes ever since I met Denzel.
I bet you have.
Yeah, well, I tell you this to begin with. I think he's a wonderful man. I think he's a great human being. And the first time I met him was at, I have a jitney station. And he happened to be at the jitney station. And while he was there, I was talking with him. And he began talking about the movie, The Hurricane. And that's where he played Reuben Hurricane Carter. Mm-hmm. And at that time, once he started talking about boxing, I said, oh, you like boxing?
Yeah.
So he said, yeah, I like boxing. I said, do you know I have a gym across the street? He said, right across the street, because the gym is right across from my apartment building that mm-hmm. I own. And he said, let's take a look at it. So he came in there, and he was really fascinated with the way it looked and mm-hmm. the size of it and the fact that the ring is there, the ring you saw, is the ring I believe Antoine Fuqua donated to the movie Southpaw.
Okay.
And he recognized the ring. And make a long story short, from that point on, he's been working out at my gym.
Okay.
Him, his personal trainer, and his bodyguard, Sal, who happens to be Sal, and Terry Claiborne is the personal trainer's name. Mm-hmm. And they're great guys, man. They work out, and they got great personalities. I think a lot of it comes from Denzel, because a lot of, not that they don't have their own personality, right. but a lot of what he says, they say some of the same thing. They're all positive people, and I enjoy that about them,
Yeah.
I even get along well with the driver, Curtis, who's a great guy, too. So we just be all together working out. So if you got any more Denzel questions, I don't know, what to say. But
you know what? I don't have any more Denzel questions, but I also know that you wrote a song and gave it to Denzel Washington in connection with the movie. Could you tell us about that?
Yeah. Well, like I say, by him being the type of person he is, he's a positive man. So he speaks about doing things and not talking about it. Mm-hmm. So I was thinking, I said to myself, he's in town. He's right across the street filming from me. I'm a musician. Why don't I write a song to go along with the movie? The movie's called Fences. I don't want to tell you about the movie because I would like for you and the public to go and see it.
Right.
But I read the book. So after reading the book, I said, okay, the song should be like this. Mm-hmm. And that's what I did. I got in touch with my band and the female vocalist who Sandra Green Camp,
right,
who did an excellent job on the song. Mm-hmm. I'm so proud of her. She did a great job. As well as I'm proud of the other musicians that were on this song.
Right.
So that's how that came about. I thought about how he speaks. Don't talk about it. Do it if you're going to do it. Don't come to me saying, I might write a song to go to your movie.
Right.
So what I did was I brought the book and I sat down and I said, I'm going to write this song and it's going to be about this book. Mm-hmm. And when you hear the song, it just goes along with the movie. Not saying that he's going to accept it and put it in the movie. Yeah. In fact, when I saw him, I said to him, hey, I wrote a song that goes to the movie. You might want to check it out. And he smiled. He said, oh, you wrote a song? I said, yeah. So I gave it to him. And about an hour later, I text Sal, is it the bodyguard's name. I text him. He said, man, Denzel loves it. And so do I. And he put a couple of exclamation points behind it. He said, we love it.
Okay.
So I said, great, But I'm thinking, well, can you use it? So I haven't heard from him until I went, and I hope I didn't intrude on him, but they were eating lunch. And I said, hey, look, how do you like the song? He said, I love it, but it tells the story. And that's why I don't want to get into it now.
Right.
Because the song tells about the movie.
Okay.
He said, but it tells the story, and I can't play it during the movie, but I love the song. I may use it in while the credits is rolling up. I said, that's what I was thinking. He said, oh, that's what you was thinking, huh? I said, well, yeah, you know. Okay. And I was, actually, because several people said the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
I could hear the song playing while the credits is rolling up.
Right.
So I did mention to him that if the lyrics are in the way, I certainly still wanted to play When You Say, but would you be interested in instrumental? He said, you have one. I said, oh, I'm working on it.
There you go.
Yeah, and he laughed because it is funny. Because, you know, I'm sure he knew I wasn't actually working on it, but I have came up with an instrumental since then.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so that's how that came about.
That's excellent, man. Well, let me ask you this, since you mentioned that, do you enjoy writing, or that was just something that you just did for this particular situation, or do you enjoy writing your own compositions?
Well, actually, I do.
You do?
I love it.
Yeah.
Especially when you nail it, and this is something I nailed. I mean, we nailed this song. I mean, I wrote it, I composed the music to it. But the musicians, I mean, wow. Mike Finch, Ronnie Biggs, man, I can't say this enough. Mark Strickland.
Yeah.
Because he did everything, man. I mean, he put the guitar in, he put the keyboards in, and it just came out great, you know.
Yeah. Well, let me ask you this. Since you like doing that, and we love hearing you, you think maybe we can get a CD of the Tubby Daniels Band, all originals?
Yeah, I know you can.
Okay, well, we're going to be looking for it.
Okay, yeah.
Well, is there anything else that we haven't talked about that you would like for people to know?
One thing that we haven't talked about that just may or may not be interest to everyone, but is interesting to me, is the fact that I find myself, I don't know if it's because I'm getting older or what, but I find myself, I love going to church, and I love being inspired by righteousness, you know, being inspired. I love my church, I love God, and I just want to thank God, you know, for my good health and, you know, just being here.
Yeah.
You know, so, I mean.
We owe it all to him, right?
That's right. And, yeah. You know, give a shout out to my pastor, Reverend Grisby, Central Baptist Church, and my family, who I love dearly. And that's basically it. I mean, music, the gym, the kids at the gym, and, you know, that's about it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you one thing, man. I really appreciate you coming back. You know, as long as I'm doing this, man, you always got a place to come. And if you want to bring the band in, because I remember the last time you were here with Dr. Leonard Johnson. You and him did an excellent performance here. So if you ever want to bring the Tubby Daniels Band, man, all you got to do is let me know, man. We'll make that happen.
Well, you mentioned Dr. Leonard Johnson. As you well know, you can't go wrong when you do anything with him. I mean, that brother's so tough, man. I did a duo, just him and I. Well, we do several duos, but I did one at his church. And he played the piano solo. He did a couple classical pieces, and then he got up and played the cello. I said, oh, wow.
I never knew he played cello.
Oh, man, he played, and he was so awesome on it, man.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of great musicians in this city, period,
oh,
man.
Oh, there is,
you know,
a lot.
Like I mentioned Mark Strickland a moment ago, and Tony Campbell, of course, and, you know, just there's so many great musicians in this city. And for me, I hear so many guys, they'd be like, this guy, that guy, but I get along with just about everyone here, man, and I enjoy playing music with them, you know, so I've been having fun. So.
Well, that's good.
Yeah.
Well, again, I thank you so much for coming on, man, and you take care of yourself.
You do the same, my brother.
And keep the music alive.
Okay, thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you ever hear about the Tubby Daniels Band performing, you owe it to yourself to get out there. They're excellent, and I guarantee you'll have a great time. Until next time. make somebody happy, make somebody strong.
Thank you.
you very much, y'all. On behalf of the Tubby Daniels Band, Howie Alexander, Ronnie Wingfield, Ronald Biggs, Mike Finch, Mrs. Sandy Green Camp, and I'm Tubby Daniels. Get ready for Ronnie Long, y'all. We hope you enjoy yourself. Thank you very much.
Tubby, thank you so much for a great, great performance. I have one request. I have one more song I want to hear. Would that be all right? Can we hear one more? We'd love to have you play one more before you come off stage. We'd love to have you play one more. Is that all right? One more? Thank you. All right. One more for Tubby and one more from Tubby. Thank you.
Inseparable. That's how we'll always be. Inseparable. Just you and me. It's so wonderful to know you'll always be around me. Incredible what you are to me. Incredible, you bring out the woman in me with your style of love. Inseparable, yeah, so we are. We're like a flower to a tree, like words to a melody of love. No words that can make us blow our thinking, 'cause we're just inseparable. That's how it is, inseparable for the rest of our years. It's so wonderful to know you'll always be around. We're like a flower to a tree, like words to a melody.
Miss Sam. Sandy Green Camp, y'all. This is Sandy Green Camp. Thank you very much.